Thanks everyone. Thanks for joining today's Velocity online training session. This is SV Tech Sup. SV Tech Sup will provide all Salesforce training and some job support, especially. But this today demo is related to Velocity. Okay. Our trainer is Dilip. He will take care of the further sessions. Okay. I already sent the detailed email, the course content, actually what we provide from the training and all. Okay. Dilip also will give more overview for this today's demo. Okay. We'll be taking care complete the Velocity training. We will make you as a Velocity expert. And also we will give some guidance in certification also. Okay. Just okay. I will give control to Dilip. He will take care the further today's demo session.
Yeah, thank you, Kishore. Good morning, everyone. Myself, Dilip. I have over 8 years.
Your voice is very low, Dilip. Sorry. Can you put your mic with you?
Yeah. Is it better now?
Yes, it's better.
Yeah. So myself, Dilip, I have over 8 years of experience. And from last 4 years, I'm especially working in Velocity. So today, we'll discuss about what exactly is Velocity and why to go for Velocity, I mean, what are the things it provides, and yeah, we'll see all those things. Right. Let me share my screen. Just a second.
You can share your screen.
Yeah. Can you all see my screen?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, great. So, yeah. So we basically tried to, our agenda today. We'll just try to understand what exactly is Velocity and you know, what are the various kinds of industry clouds provided by Velocity and what are the advantages of using Velocity. And there are certain out-of-the-box features. We'll try to understand the basics of it today. I mean, what exactly they are and why to use them when we are already Salesforce. And, you know, there are so, we can do so much in Salesforce, but why exactly Velocity? Right. Yeah. First of all, let's just have a little bit of introduction. Like usually, in not just in Salesforce, but usually in any cloud domain, we get three different types of services which we get, right? So usually, the first one would be the infrastructure as a service, which basically is like they try to provide you the storage or services or servers or network. It's basically the basic infrastructure that is required. So that will be provided by a cloud service company as a service. Or if you move on, there is another thing called PaaS, which is platform as a service. So this is nothing but using this infrastructure provided by these cloud companies, we can build a platform just like we have Viva CRM or Tableau or CPQ for that matter, and yeah, Velocity as well. So they use this infrastructure and provide, they use the Salesforce and provide as a new platform, and we can use that platform to deliver a software or something. And finally, the SaaS, which we all know about, which is the main service of Salesforce, right? Whenever we all work in Salesforce project, it's nothing but basically, we are using the entire Salesforce application as a platform, and we try to build some kind of software and deliver it to the customers, right? So here Velocity is using the PaaS service of the Salesforce, right? So they use this Salesforce and build a platform around it, and that will be provided to us, and we can utilize that to build a software again on top of this platform, right? So when it comes to Velocity, right, what exactly, is there? Let's just try to understand it. So usually before getting into Velocity, let's talk about the business flows which goes around, right? For example, let's take a, I mean, the latest trending thing is like, we have this pandemic and we have lots of vaccinations are going on, right? So usually what happens with the vaccines or how these companies, I mean, in India, it's a different scenario. You can just go to any medical shop and you can get any drugs you want. But usually that's not the case in North America or Europe or Australia, where, I mean, other parts of the world, right? You need to have a prescription in order to get a medicine, right? There's a whole flow goes behind before that medicine is actually available in the market, right? So this, let's say Pfizer or let's say Novartis, all these are, you can say these are all pharma companies. So let's say they want to, you know, create a new drug. First of all, you know, they do a lot of clinical trials. I mean, they have different phases of clinical trials. Once they are all successful, they will, each of these companies will have their own sales executives. They go to the hospitals or doctors who are their customers, and they try to explain the product. They try to give the compounds, I mean, what are the compounds, composition of this product, and they'll try to give more details about what exactly this product is and what are all the positives of it, what are all the side effects you may get, all these details. If the doctor or these hospitals prefer using this particular drug, I mean, you can see for cold, common cold, you would be finding various drugs from each and every company, right? You may find some drugs from Reddy's Laboratory. You may find some tablets from Pfizer or something, right? So these starts, these doctors or hospitals starts prescribing these specific drugs, right? Which are provided by this company, right? So this way they have a whole flow, a business flow. Right. Although the technology may differ, they want to build an application maybe in Salesforce to take care of all this CRM process, or they may want to build a application or software using maybe a Siebel or Java or whatever it is. The business flow is always going to be the same, right? So that's what Velocity has captured here, and that's where their entire business lies, right? So they have identified certain business flows that are specific to each domain, right? Like they have communications, media and entertainment, energy and utilities, insurance, health, government, and they're bringing in more of these kind of domains. So what exactly when we say industries or domains means, it's basically they have identified that, okay, no matter what the technology is, ultimately the business process is always going to be the same. The flow of business is always going to be the same, right? The way they try to sell their products and the way they try to engage with the customers is always going to be the same, no matter what kind of platform you use to build your application, right? For example, let's consider telecom domain, which is the kind of a topmost in Velocity, right? So in telecom domain, I mean, unlike India or, you know, you can say Asia, outside how usually it goes is they'll have a website and your customers go in and they try to order their SIM card. They try to choose a new number for that. And, you know, they choose some plans and they proceed with the payment and the SIM card gets delivered to them. So this is their business flow. And Velocity has identified it and created a data model, so which will which can be used by this, you know, telecom companies, and that data model is not just some kind of customized, completely customized one. They're using the existing standard Salesforce objects and extending its standard Salesforce data model. They're just trying to extend it and provide us a more complex and more dynamic data model, which will which can be used for each industry, right? Let's dig a little deeper into that. Right, if you see, there are actually so many clients that are actually working for using Velocity. Right, these are the few names which we may be aware of, like Verizon, British Telecom, Rogers, M1 Telecom. For that matter, even Vodafone has started using Velocity. very recently. So they have, overall across the domains, Velocity has more than around 250 plus clients, 250 plus customers using Velocity. Now let's just see what exactly, what are the advantages of, using Velocity. Yeah, first and foremost thing is, we all know that Salesforce data model is a very strong one. I mean, any CRM or any sales, who want to use the sales cloud or service cloud, they get this data model whenever they start using Salesforce, and which is actually a strong one. I mean, you can use certain objects or not, it's up to you, but it's the data model is so good. That's why so many clients are actually using Salesforce, right? So Velocity, utilizing the existing standard Salesforce data model and objects, and extending it in a way which can be used for each and every domain separately, right? For example, let's consider telecom domain. Right, in telecom domain, they are using users, accounts, contacts. They are using orders, order line items, asset objects. These are all standard objects, right? On top of these objects, they are created more objects around these objects and created certain relationships. So it's like you are using the standard Salesforce data model and few other extra objects and extra relationships, which will suffice your requirement in your telecom domain, right? The same goes in insurance domain. In insurance, most of the thing revolves around quote and quote line items. Basically, it's all about quote management, right? So that way, Velocity is extending Salesforce data model in order to make sure that they provide industry-specific data models for each different domain, right? Next thing is we'll discuss about this particular point in detail in the further. It's basically you can build business flows with complex functionalities in a very fast and a very quick way, right? I actually show you and how easy it is going to be when you use Velocity. For example, let's say Vodafone wants a new web application now, right? They have already one, but let's say they don't want to use it anymore. They want a new one, which is implemented in Salesforce, right? If they use Velocity, let's say they have to, from the first page till the payment page, like till the user goes to the payment, there could be a lot of multiple different pages, right? The first page, maybe they could be showing their product information. Once the user selects a particular product, they'll give you more details. They'll ask you some more details. They'll ask you account details, all these things, finally payment. Let's say there are 10 different web pages you have to build, right? If you are going for a normal Salesforce, for that matter, any other platform to build this, right? You have to spend in a lot of time just to build the front end. And again, you have to spend in a lot of time to build this complex backend logic, all of this. But when these customers start using Velocity, all that can be done in a very quick pace, right? So how exactly is, because Velocity is providing certain data tools and interaction tools, right, which are basically a configurable one. You don't have to use even a single line of code, right, to build all these applications and all. And you can simply, by dragging and dropping, you can build complex logics and complex applications. Right? Usually, in the early days of Salesforce, they used to promote themselves like it's 70% of configuration and only 30% of customization. But is that really happening? No, right? Whenever you go across any Salesforce application, you see, they are so code heavy. At some point of time, they are eventually breaking. I mean, it is happening in a lot of applications. Like, they again have to spend in a lot of time to optimize their codes. They again have to spend in a lot of time to reduce the burden on the whole application and all. You see, like, it's 80% of the application is completely customizable, right? So which makes the application so code heavy. So every page that loads will take a lot of time to execute all those backend logics or front-end logics, whatever, right? But well, in Velocity, it actually sticks to that part, right? If you use Velocity, I can clearly say that almost 80% of the logic or front-end or back-end, whatever it is, both of them can be built using by simple drag and drop functionality. And only around 20% to add in like a rich UI or maybe some complex which needs to be built. Only those cases we have to go for the code. Otherwise, mostly it is going to be configuration. I'll show you some examples as well, right? And integrating with other systems becomes quite easy. I mean, we usually have a middleware of like MuleSoft or APG or whatever, right? So if you, in order to invoke an API of MuleSoft, right, how much time do we really take, right, to utilize that data and process that and all, right? You, at least even for a person who is good, in coding and with Apex, right? At least he'll take a half a day, right, to build a, API and all. But in Velocity, you can hardly do it in under 10 minutes. I'll show you how to do that, right? And for in some cases, there are applications which are responsive, right? Responsive in the sense every clickable button on the UI is basically an API call being made in the backend, right? So that means in Salesforce, we have to expose our data by, exposing our APIs to external systems, right? To expose our APIs, it is going to get much more complex. We have to build, so much of logic and all of that using Apex code, right? But you, when you use, start using Velocity, covering all those positive and negative scenarios, it hardly takes, less than a day to build an end-to-end API. It's going to be that simple. And the last thing is, in Velocity, we mostly 99% of the times we are going to use JSON as a data processing format, right? So we'll in further classes we'll try to understand JSON as well, because that is going to be pretty important in Velocity. So when you use JSON, basically JSON is a very lightweight language, right? Even you don't even have to have knowledge on how JSON is going to look, but the moment you look at a JSON structure, it doesn't take much time to actually understand what is going on, what kind of data you're passing and all. Even if you don't have any idea, but still if you look at a JSON structure, you'll understand what exactly is going on. So it is very easy to understand. It is a faster processing and it is a very lightweight language. So that makes Velocity, it's kind of a easier processing, and faster, language. Yeah. Right. So now let's see what exactly Velocity is providing the clients are getting attracted to, this Velocity so much, right? It's been almost initially, it's been almost more than 6 years they have coming to picture, but from the last 2 years, they have, I think more than 200 clients have started using Velocity in the last 2 years itself. Their impact is so much that now Salesforce themselves have acquired Velocity and they've integrated everything, both Velocity and Salesforce. Now it's all just one thing, right? Yeah. Let's see what all the things they do. First thing is they provide you order capture, right? Let's dig a little deeper into order capture. This is Velocity, and I'll show you how simple it is. It goes like this. You choose your plans and everything, and you choose your add-ons, and you choose a particular number. And there is a place where you can review your entire order, and they can you can proceed by creating an account and finally doing the payment. This is a actual telecom website. You can search for yourself in Google, looking for M1 telecom website, and it gives you can go through this, see this website. This entire website, I mean, I worked in this particular project, you know, maybe 2 years back. This entire website, end to end, had been built using Velocity, right? And to deliver, I mean, it's not just this thing. There is another, again, different kind of flow for already existing customers who can just simply log in and change their existing plans, or, you know, remove an add-on or add an add-on or all these things, right? So there are around 3 different flows and almost like 15 different web pages are needed. And there is a lot of, you know, backend logic that had to be implemented. This whole project was delivered in 6 months. And trust me, if it was a Salesforce application or for that matter, any other app platform, it would have taken at least 2 years to build this entire thing. Yeah. So, first thing, we'll start about order capture. Order capture is nothing but if you take Amazon, Amazon website, order capture is nothing but from the time you enter Amazon's website till the time you do the payment, that entire process is called order capture. And this is standard for every sales platforms, not just specific to telecom or not just specific to insurance or whatever. Is across all domains, sales standards, sales processes, this, right? From the time a user enters a particular website till he may go through a lot of process like choosing his products and all, giving his account details, till the time he does the payment, right? Till the order is submitted in the backend, that whole process is called order capture, right? Even if you in Amazon, there may be more different pages. Like in Amazon, you can shop by categories and you can choose particular product category. And then you can choose by brands, or you can choose by, you know, various filters are there. You can choose a particular product, maybe a mobile phone. It shows you all the mobile phone details. Then you go ahead and proceed till the payment page, right? So this whole part, this whole process is called order capture. And to build an order capture journey, usually you require a lot of coding skills, a lot of time has to be invested in order to, you know, develop a order capture journey from end to end, right? But Velocity provides you a declarative approach to implement most of this logic, and you don't have to use, you know, any code in this whole process, right? Only for adding the UI, extra UI, additional UI features, you may have to use code. Otherwise, you don't have to use at all, right? Next thing is order management. I mean, for example, you got a product, you ordered a product in Amazon. It's their job is not yet done, right? From the time they do the payment till the time the product actually gets delivered to the customer, they have to do a lot of processing. For example, you're ordering a mobile phone, right? Mobile phone, all these mobile phones must be coming from a specific inventory, right? They have to take that product from that inventory. They have to first verify the product is available or not. If it is available, they have to get it and they have to dispatch it and, get that product, the nearest hub to the customer, and then eventually let the product go out for delivery, and finally the customer gets it, right? There is a lot of process that is happening in the backend. That whole process is called order management, and Velocity provides you the most dynamic and most complex, yet very simple and configurable order management process. And in terms of Velocity, it is called as orchestration and decomposition. We'll see about all these things individually in depth when we actually start our sessions. But yeah. This is a basic idea, right? From the time a customer enters into a website till the time he does the payment, that is called his order capture. And from the time the payment is done till the product actually gets delivered to the customer. That is called as order management. And this whole process can be built, the both front end and back end. All of these logics can be implemented in declarative approach when you are using Velocity, right? Especially this orchestration part, order management part, right? It actually involves a lot of things. For example, if you are buying a SIM card online, right? SIM card and a plan online, like maybe you got an Vodafone SIM online, right? First thing is they have to verify your documents, right? Whether you are a genuine customer or not. And you have to first verify whether the customer is genuine or not. So for that, you do the document verification. Then you tag a particular mobile number to that SIM card. Then there are some other IDs that gets tagged in the backend, right? And you deliver the product. I mean, you go to some, Blue Dart or something to get the product delivered. Once that is delivered, you have to activate the SIM, right? So there is a whole lot of process that involves in the backend, right? So Velocity provides us this orchestration and decomposition process, which is basically comes under order management category. That is so dynamic. You yourself will see that, like, it's like based on the products user has chosen, this has to be changed for each and every product. I mean, if SIM card is there, if SIM card has been bought by a customer, then yeah, I have to do the document verification and all. But if a customer comes in and just buys the plan, you don't have to do all that. Once he buys the plan, all you have to do is activate it, right? So each product has a different kind of order management process that goes on, right? So Velocity provides you the most dynamic one, right? And the next thing that is provided by Velocity is EPC, which is called as Enterprise Product Catalog, right? So this basically means, let's say, for example, let's take another website, Visible, which is a Verizon's subsidiary, right? Which is a US-based company, and Visible is Verizon's subsidiary. And this is also a Velocity product, a Velocity client, right? In this particular project, in this particular company, along with SIM cards and plans, they also sell mobile phones, just like how it happens in Flipkart and Amazon in India. You can choose mobile phones here, and you can users can buy the mobile phones along with the SIM card and a plan directly from their website, right? So basically, all these products have to be configured in backend so that you can use those products and display it to the customers, and they can buy it and proceed with their process, right? So Velocity again provides you something called EPC, which will lets you do certain complex which lets you implement certain complex logics in creating your product catalog. Right, it comes up with lots of new features, something called attributes, all of those things, right? So it provides you certain complex features to implement your product catalog in a very efficient way, right? And next comes the Velocity CPQ, right? Velocity CPQ is nothing but, Velocity is using CPQ as well in order to do the pricing, right? It's a little different to compared to what you actually see in CPQ. They have customized, Velocity has customized it by their own, by adding some of their logics, and it provides you again most dynamic way of pricing your products, right? For example, if I buy Samsung Galaxy A12 mobile, and if I buy a SIM card and a plan together, all of these products, it may cost you less. But if I buy a SIM card and a plan separately, it may cost me a little more, right? So you'll be able to create a complex bundle of products, or you can buy, users can buy, products, three or four products together, or you can sell those products individually, or there could be a lot of, scenarios that come into picture when you actually are selling these products, right? So For all that purposes, you can simply use Velocity CPQ to do the pricing. And why I keep saying dynamic, why I keep using dynamic for word for every Velocity feature is that's what actually they are doing, right? They are providing you the dynamic way of pricing. They are providing you as the dynamic way of creating product catalog. Again, dynamic way of creating the order management process and all of that, right? And next comes in is digital commerce and card-based APIs, right? This is nothing but each domain have, for example, telecom domain, right? They have certain processes. No matter the software you are using, there are certain logics or functionalities that have to be implemented in that specific domain, right? So what Velocity has done is Velocity has identified these kind of certain functionalities, and they have done their part, like done all that coding or whatever is required, and they provide all of those functionalities as an API to us, right? So all we have to do is simply call that API and pass in some inputs, and it will take care of executing that logic from their side and provide us with the response, right? So that's when digital commerce and card-based APIs come into the picture, and they're actually very useful because there are certain functionalities. I mean, for example, in telecom domain, we use order and order line item objects, right? Ideally, when you write a test class, how irritating it is, let's be frank, how irritating it is to create a simple order object, right? You have to take care of a lot of things like creating a price book entry, price list entry, and creating a product, and creating creating an order and order line item, right? So you have to do a lot of processing, and for all of this, you have to use a lot of coding, right? But Velocity provides, creating an order is a basic thing in every, online sales process, right? So you don't have to bother about creating the order, just pass in the right inputs and call a particular Velocity API, and it will take care of everything else. Like it creates order, it creates order line items, it adds all the required details to, this order and order line item objects, and it gives you the whole, everything, and it provides as a response. So this way they are making you avoid a lot of complex logics that have to be built by you, and finally they are providing these industry specific data models. When we actually work in Velocity, I'll try to explain more clearly and how exactly they are doing this. For example, a simple example is all these companies are going to offer some kind of promotions, right? So in the backend, this actually is nothing but a product sales. There is a standard Salesforce object called product catalog, right? Product 2, which is the API name for that object, right? This particular thing is nothing but a record in product catalog, right? So Velocity using this product catalog object, and once you choose this product and go ahead, it converts that into your order and order line item records. And for example, if you, let's say this is a new customer and you want to offer some kind of promotion, so you will be able to apply some promotions or referral codes or all these things. So around this promotion, product and order and order line item objects, they have created this, something called promotions or all these things. You can see there is a promotional gift, Amazon Fire Stick, Fire TV Stick, and all these things, right? You can provide they have created certain objects to, make sure that these kind of additional functionalities can be implemented in a dynamic way. Right, and before going ahead and trying to understand these Velocity components, let's just I'll give you some details about these particular things. There are a lot of other companies that are actually using Velocity, and you can search for all of those, like Rogers Telecom, process communication or tellers, or you know, there are so many other clients that are using Velocity, and you can go through their websites and you can see for yourself how their websites are built. And I like actually show you how they can be built in by simply using the Velocity features, which are configurable. Right. So, first thing is Velocity is providing us two sets of components. First one is interaction tools, and others are data tools. Interaction tools is nothing but the ones which we deal with the UI front end part, right? So, and data tools are nothing but the ones which deal with the back end part, right? Whatever happens in the back end logic, all that can be implemented using these. Let's consider this OmniScripts. So this is a Velocity tool that is basically like a, it's a like for like replacement of your Visual Force page or Lightning component or a LWC component. I mean, you can simply say that, right? So let's just give an example of OmniScript, right? It's OmniScript is nothing but, I mean, the name itself suggests that Omni is nothing but a guided flow. That's the actual meaning of Omni. So OmniScript is nothing but you create a script which lets you flow, follow a guided flow in order to complete a business process, right? That's the actual meaning of your OmniScript. So what it actually means is, for example, let's consider Amazon. Here, in order to buy a product, you can see they have designed the screen in such a way that, right, you will be able to go and choose your products, and eventually you'll be able to go and proceed till the payment, right? You can see there is no back button or anything here. Yeah. Or if in case you have to go back, all you have to do is use the browser back button, but they don't provide a back button at all. So it's kind of a business tactic usually that will be used across the, you know, online sales process. For example, I want to buy a mobile. So here I'm launched into a product screen where I can choose all the products that are available, right? Yeah, here I can see this product details and all. I can click on add to cart, right? And if I go to proceed to checkout, now I can see this order review page where I am just seeing what are all the items that are added into the cart. Then I click on proceed to buy. If I'm a new customer, it asks for, you know, all new details, like what is my name, first name, last name, email, phone number, address details, all these things. If I'm already existing customer, I can simply log in and choose my address and eventually go to the payment. You can see this whole thing is like a business flow that they have created. Right, there is no back button here. You'll not be able to go back to a particular place. All you can do is you have certain buttons and links. You can click on that. You can navigate across the screens. Finally, their main aim is to sell their products in a more dynamic way. Right, you can choose a product. You can review the product. You can proceed on to give your account details and finally to the payment. Right, so all these online, any online sales, you know, any e-commerce places, right? You usually find this kind of flow, right? You, in order to build this kind of user flow, usually you would require, if it is Salesforce, you would require a Visual Force page or a Lightning, lots of Lightning components and LWC components, right? And you have to embed all of those into a community page or whatever. And usually it takes a lot of time to build those components. And each of those components again require an Apex controller to execute the backend logic, right? For example, on click of collect coupons, something should happen in the backend, right? So yeah, all these things, I mean, every clickable button, every clickable link has some kind of backend logic that needs to be again implemented, which needs again a lot of coding. In your Apex controller, you have to add a lot of detail. I mean, a lot of, you have to execute, a lot of processing has to be done, right? All that can be done, by simply using OmniScripts, which is a completely configurable declarative approach thing, right? I'll show you this exact client itself. I mean, how they have been built and all. Yeah, here you can see this exact page is right. This is nothing but an OmniScript where you can, all that you are seeing in this page is a simple drag and drop function, drag and drop things, components in the backend, which we used in the OmniScript, right? So you can create, you know, complex UI pages by simple drag and drop features, right? So I'll actually show you one example. Yeah, that page you had just seen, right? That is nothing but this. I mean, yeah, although now we are using, I mean, a different version of it is being used, but yeah, ultimately this is that page. And you can see all of these components are just simple drag and drop, right? It has front end logic, it has back end logics, all of that. All you have to do is you just have to find the right element which is required, and you have to, you just simply drag and drop that. And you pass in some inputs and it displays in the front end. That's all, right? Usually, I mean, I'll just give you an overview of this page itself. I'll tell you what are all the logics that have been implemented. Here, the numbers you see here, right? Every time I refresh, basically a new set of numbers will be displayed. So basically in the backend, I'm calling an API, right? So that's one API call, right? And here, usually in the previous page, we have to give a zip code or something. Based on that, it will retrieve an address. So this is another API call here. And you can see this is delivery date is also customized. It only shows the next 7 days, right? Here also this kind of logic implemented. And based on this, it shows the delivery timings which are available. So again, there is a complex logic implemented in the backend. And there is another scenario for port in customers who are wants to port into M1 with their existing mobile number. They can give their number, and on entering their number, we are actually running another validation, which lets us know whether that is a another company's number or this current company's number or not. Basically, there is a validation that happens. That is another API call. And yeah, here you choose the what is your previous telecom operator and all of that. And there's another option here. Instead of delivery, you can just pick up, right? So based on your address, by default, it gives you a certain nearby locations and all, right? So again, that is another API call being made. So if you see here in this one single screen, there are around 4 to 5 different API calls, and there are certain complex logics that have been involved, both in front end and back end. And once user clicks on next, I mean, if he goes on to the next page, we have to save a lot of data. I mean, the number which user picks, right, that needs to be saved into the Salesforce database, and the delivery time, delivery date, all this has to be passed to the Salesforce database. And whenever I pick a number, that basically has to be reserved, right? So that other users who are in the website at that moment should not be able to see that number again, right? So I have to make another API call to make sure that the number is reserved. And if it is a port in, then you enter your number, I validate that. And usually in other countries, right, whenever you're opting for a port in, they give you a temporary number, right? That means till the time this number gets activated in the current telecom domain, they give you a temporary mobile number which can be used till that particular point of time. So again, you have to fetch a new mobile number, and that has to be reserved. And yeah, so all of this logic, imagine doing all of this in Salesforce using a Lightning component, or and using a you know, multiple Lightning components, and using an Apex controller to execute certain logics, right? It let's say it at least takes 2 sprints to develop all this, right? Two sprints, in the sense, at least you need, you know, 3 to 4 weeks to develop this entire thing. But if you use an Omniscript, when I was very new when I started this particular project, and I had no idea how to use an Omniscript, but still I was able to deliver this particular whole functionality in just one single sprint. That means, which was, you know, just 2 weeks. That means hardly 10 working days. I was able to build this entire logic and I was able to deliver it. Why? Because everything is simple, configurable thing. Like even the API calls that I make are a simple configuration thing. Like I can just simply drag and drop certain things and it is going to work, you know, and it is actually going to be like how you are implementing in Apex itself, right? So instead of implementing whole VF page or lightning components, multiple lightning components, you can simply use a Omniscript, which is a completely drag and drop component. Right. And next thing is cards and flexi cards. I mean, this is nothing but it's like every company needs to have a customer care, right? So customer care agents, I mean, they should be in a position, right? When a customer calls in, after getting the basic information from him, after verifying whether he's a genuine customer or not, customer care agents should be able to see all of that customer's information in one single screen. Plus, he should be able to perform certain kinds of action, right? So that, for that purpose, to build those kind of customer console screens, we have something called cards that are provided by Velocity, right? It is nothing but it just simply gives you a 360 degree view of a customer, right? I'll give you a better example. Yeah, this is one of the telecom clients' customer care screen, right? The moment a customer calls in and tells his account number, right, we'll try to fetch all information by just one single click, right? So we'll display his account information, he will display his previous orders, we'll display the current handset which is active and a current plan which is active, the add-ons which he has, and we show certain links to, I mean, let's say customer calls in and says that, can you please download my bill and send it to my email, or, you know, those kind of things, or update my alternate contact number, all those things, right? All of that can be done in one single screen, and that is called cards. And again, this is completely configurable. You don't have to use a single line of code, you know, to build this entire screen, both front-end and back-end logics, right? And finally, there is something called templates. Templates is nothing but, for example, if you are using Facebook, right? There are some applications in Facebook, like, excuse for me. Example, like, yeah.
I'm sorry to interrupt. Did you say about the flexi cards?
Yeah, cards and flexi cards are almost similar. It's like, it's an updated version of flexi cards. They have recently introduced this. I mean, I don't want to confuse too much, so I didn't get into more details. Basically, their ultimate goal of using cards is to provide the 360 degree view of customer and to perform certain actions, all of that in a single screen.
Okay. And the validation is taken care in the backend by dragging and dropping the button, right?
Right, exactly. Yeah. We'll come to that point. We'll see how to do all those kinds of things. Yeah. How to implement backend logics. Yeah. Right, templates is nothing but, in Facebook, right? Let's say you open your Facebook app and you'd see certain kinds of applications like which say like which Hollywood hero you look like, or which Marvel character you look like, or something like that, right? So Facebook's theme is blue, right? Whatever you do, it always comes in blue and white theme, right? But these applications have extra coloring. I mean, they don't follow this Facebook blue standard, but they implement their own kind of, you know, themes. Some would be in red color or orange color, or all those things, right? So for that purpose, even in Salesforce, course, everything is in blue, like this light blue color, right? Anything you implement is going to come in light blue color itself, right? So velocity also kind of follows that standard. When you build a plain structure, a plain OmniScript, right, with all the required functionalities and all, everything is going to come in this light blue color, right? So in order to add that rich UI context to your thing, like for example, this particular client wants everything in orange, right? They have this orange kind of theme. Anything you see is basically, you know, highlighted with the orange theme. So in order to provide our, you can see there is a backend image that is there in the back, right? At the back, right? So in order to, you know, customize your UI, like provide additional, you know, thing to richness to your UI, we use templates, which is basically completely Angular JavaScript, right? So this is the only place where you have to use code and you have to use Angular JavaScript in order to add this rich UI, richness to the UI, right? Now, even that, since this AngularJS is not exactly native to Salesforce, right? It is some other external platform, right? So that means there will be a little bit of lag between interacting with these two systems, Salesforce and this, you know, Angular JavaScript, right? To avoid that, very recently, they have come up with LWC itself. Instead of using templates, you can go ahead and use LWC components to add that richness to your UI. We'll see all of that maybe when we have these sessions. Right? That's the whole idea of having these templates. Now we are calling it as LWC templates, but earlier we used to, even now we still have these Angular templates. They are just there to add the richness to the UI, right? Mostly adding kind of CSS or, you know, all those certain things. Right. Any questions or any clarifications you need so far? Right. I take that as a no. And yeah, let's just proceed. Right. When it comes to data tools, right? For example, you're building this whole page, but UI is built and all of that is good, but it needs certain backend logic also needs to be implemented, right? Just like how you create a Lightning component, but you need to have a, you know, Apex controller to in order to control the backend logic, right? So for that purpose, Velocity is providing you with these kind of components, which are data tools, right? So they are providing something called data raptors. I mean, we can talk about them in detail when we have sessions, but data raptors is data raptor is nothing but it is used to work with all kinds of data manipulation things, right? All your most of the DML operations and your queries can be done using these data raptors, right? For example, if you consider data raptor extract, right? It is nothing but a replacement of your SOQL query. And you can usually for SOQL query, you have to write that select so-and-so fields from so-and-so object with filter condition and all, right? But you can do that using configuration by using a data raptor extract, right? And data raptor extracts are like much more, you can make them much more complex, right? You can extract any number of objects data, even they are not even related, right? And you can apply any number of formulas and all. I'll show you one example just let you know how complex a single data raptor can get, yet it is so simple for a developer to develop all that, right? And there is data raptor load, which is like, you know, which is used to upsert or update or insert any data to Salesforce, right? So for that purpose, we use a data raptor load. And again, you can work with any number of objects which are not even related, and you can apply so many formulas, all of that before loading the data in Salesforce, right? So, and there is something called data raptor transform. It is just to manipulate your JSON structure. We'll talk about that later on. And the more interesting thing here is integration procedures here, right? So integration procedures are nothing but the like for like replacement of your Apex class, right? So whatever your Apex class does, whatever your Apex controller does, almost 98% of that logic can be built using integration procedures, just by dragging and dropping certain things, right? And you can invoke an API, you can expose an API, all of that can be done using integration procedure. I'll show you one example here. There is one specific requirement where we have to generate a contract, right, for that user, right? Generating a contract is not that simple, right? You have to extract data from so many objects, right? To simply say, it's like you have to extract details from account, address, orders, order line items. Yeah, there are so many other objects that needs to be dealt with. And this is a data raptor extract. This is how it looks. You can see these are all the objects that we are working with. And you can see the number of formulas that are applied. And yeah, right? And you can extract any number of fields. These are all, you use JSON, right? So in order to extract fields, you have to define a specific JSON structure. So that's why this looks a little different here. Right, so you can see how one single data raptor can be used to, you know, execute, you know, with basically to work with so many objects using so many formulas. And why I keep saying these formulas again and again is basically, it's not just simple if or simple concat formulas or text formulas or whatever. Velocity gives you that extra liberty to create your own formulas. I mean, we'll discuss that in detail. But yeah, that is one additional feature provided by Velocity, right? And let's see the integration procedure, right? I keep telling about integration procedure, right? So basically, in order to invoke an API, you need to write an Apex class with, you know, at least some, you know, few lines of code, and you have to have some good knowledge of that. But in case of if you use an integration procedure, a Velocity integration procedure, all you have to do is, there is this kind, I mean, Velocity gives you something like this, like some available components, and you can simply drag and drop them here and configure them in a way you want, right? So here, this is one simple example I wanted to show. We are making a call to MuleSoft to get the available numbers so that we can display it in this particular page to the user, right? So in order to do that, usually you require, some code or something. But here, all I did is just drag and drop this HTTP action. I'll give my endpoint here. I'll give what type of method it is. And I'll give you, I'll give these headers and parameters. And that's it. I just click on execute. You can see I'm getting all this data from external system. So it's that simple to make an integration call out to some external system, right? Let's consider another example. Right, this, I'll tell you the scenario before going ahead. When a user, let's say I'm already existing customer to Vodafone, right? That means I can come back to Vodafone app anytime, and I can deactivate certain add-ons or activate certain add-ons. I can modify my existing add-on to, you know, like for example, caller tune is there. I can activate it anytime to my mobile number or deactivate it anytime or change my song or whatever it is, right? So for all that, in the backend, we have to implement certain logic, right? So usually you need, you know, much complex kind of, you know, code that is required to perform all kinds of negative scenarios and positive scenarios, right? you can see this is an integration procedure, and all of the integration procedure has only configurable components, right? I mean, you may get confused by looking at all of this on the properties and everything, but yeah, it's ultimately, it's just a drag and drop, and you just define certain properties, right? So much complex structure has been implemented here to handle all that add-on related things in using one single integration procedure, right? To modify or to update or to add, delete or deactivate or subscribe to new one, all of those scenarios, for each and every scenario, there will be positive and negative outcomes. So all of that can be handled, are handled actually in the single integration procedure, right? And another example is basically, for example, mobile apps. Let's consider a mobile app, Zomato, right? Zomato is nothing but a responsive mobile app. That means responsive mobile app is means front end is always going to be just, you know, like it doesn't have any logic, right? So in the front end, any clickable button or any clickable link or any basically anything you click, right? Basically, it makes an API call to the backend system and fetches those information. Even for that matter, Facebook itself is a responsive mobile app, right? You open the Facebook app, the moment you open it, you see a small loader that appears on the page. Then after some time, it displays all the feed, right? That basically means it is making an API call, trying to fetch the, you know, latest feed. And you, let's say you click on edit your profile. So it you go into that page and you change anything and click on save. It loads for a bit and loads onto the next page. That basically means it's making an API call, passing the data that has been changed to the database so that the database is updated, right? So in order to, for all these requirements, you need APIs, right? That needs to be exposed to the external systems, right? That also can be done using integration procedure. You can expose your APIs simply using integration procedures and perform complex logics. For example, this thing is nothing but in your Amazon for this particular page. I mean, let's say this is a mobile app, right? So mobile apps will have UI from Android or iOS, right? So this, for the moment, let's consider this as a mobile app, right? So when I click on this cart symbol in the mobile app, it is basically launching me here where I can see all the items that I've added in the cart. That means there should be an API, there must be an API call running in the backend, for example. Yeah, I clicked it, you can see the page loads, and maybe yeah, it loaded instantly because of the cache memory, but when you load it for the first time, it takes a little while, right? That basically means it is making an API call in the backend where you would have written your logic to extract all the information for that particular order and display it. So this is one that kind of scenario where I'll try to fetch all the order information. I'll just show you one example itself. You can see, I'll just pass the order ID over here. And the API is going to fetch all the information, and this data will be used to display it in the UI, right? For example, talk time plan is 100, that means maybe 100 minutes or something. SMS plan is like 100 again, that means 100 SMS. And yeah, other details, order number, whether it is a port in or not, all these details and the products that I have chosen, for example. This $10 talk time and SMS pack has been chosen, and what is the price of it? What is the monthly price of it? The quantity of it? All of these details, and right. So this way, you can expose your Salesforce data using an integration procedure, and everything is, you can see it's all configurable. You just on the left hand side, whatever is provided, right, that you can simply drag and drop into the center, and on the right hand side, you can just configure those elements, right. you just define like what is the input of it. Just now we have seen this number management page where HTTP action is a component that is provided by Velocity, which performs the logic of invoking an API. You just drag and drop it here into the structure. And on the right hand side, you just define, right, what is the endpoint and what is the parameters and headers, right? So this way you configure a HTTP action. That's how you'll be able to configure all these, you know, components that are provided by Velocity. Right. And coming to calculation procedures, that is nothing but it's like a, there could be, I mean, it's predominantly used in insurance domain where you have to, you know, perform a lot of calculations based on the user, based on user selection of product, right? In insurance domain, you basically choose a policy and you choose your beneficiaries and you choose like what kind of claims and everything, right? So based on that, you have to perform a lot of calculations and provide, price which is going to premium you have to pay and all that, right? So for that purpose, you use a calculation procedure in order to, make sure that all that calculation can be done. Yeah, calculation procedure is nothing but to perform complex mathematical logics, you can use a calculation procedure. This is how Velocity is providing us these interaction tools and data tools, which we can use to perform all those complex logics we have been talking about, and both front end and back end, right? So this is one such page, right? This is that number management page, which is basically here. Yeah, although it is changed a little bit now, but yeah, this is how it can be built, right? You can see, yeah, this is how it has been built. And ultimately this OmniScript can be placed as a component in your community, and that community you can provide access to external users and they can come in and see, use that particular website, right? So this is how Velocity is providing us these tools, not just these tools. These tools, whenever we talk about these interaction tools and data tools, they're only specific to one part of what Velocity is providing out of so many other parts. Like these interaction tools and data tools are just part of order capture journey, right? These tools let you, capture the information that is required to fulfill your order. That's all, right? There are so many other things that are provided by Velocity, like orchestration, decomposition, and EPC, CPQ, this card-based and digital commerce APIs. If you start using all of these, you will be able to see, you yourself will be able to understand why development becomes so fast when it comes to Velocity. Right. So any questions or anything? You can ask me now. Yeah.
The integration part. Mm-hmm. After we calling, if you are entering a wrong data in there, is there any chance we can take back and put the right thing?
You mean like to handle the negative scenarios?
Yeah.
Yeah, right. True. That's a good question, actually. For example, this particular integration procedure is used to extract all the order-related information. Right, so let's say I pass some random value over here. I can throw an error message saying that basically with this ID, there is no order record in Salesforce, and that's why I'm showing an error. Or if, let's say, if I don't pass this, if I don't pass any value at all, so it is saying required fields are not provided. So basically, that's what. Whatever you do in Apex code also, when you are exposing an API, first thing is you do handle a positive scenario. That means how when all the right data has been passed, how the data has to come, and then you can handle all the negative scenarios. In the same way, you can do all of that in your integration procedure. Not just that, you can do much more things. Like, for example, in Salesforce, we use try-catch block to handle all your exceptions. You can even do that as well. I mean, these are all the errors that we show when there is some kind of miss from the their side, right? But let's say some of the logic from our side itself has failed. So how are you going to handle those scenarios? Basically using this, just like how Salesforce we have try-catch, you have this try-catch block over here, and you can configure it in a way, either display a message or store the logs or whatever it is.
Exactly. That's what my question is. Like, if we write a code, Apex code in the developer console, if it is like wrong coding, it will not be saved, right? The same way, I'm just to make sure that whatever we're entering is right, I'm just thinking whether it will be like the same way it will be like giving us the error message so that we'll fix it and we'll save it, like create it.
True. That can be handled. I mean, these errors are functional errors, but if you face any technical errors, like let's say you're getting a null pointer exception in your code, right? If you use a try-catch block, it shows the exact line, right, where it is you are getting the error, and it shows the stack trace, and it shows all the error details and all. If you use a try-catch block here also in integration procedure, like it gives you the exact details, like which particular element is throwing you that error, and which what is the error, and what all the error details.
Okay, got it. Thank you.
Yeah.
Hi, Dilip.
Yeah, hi.
Actually, I have been working on similar kind of e-commerce portal from last few years. But it's all on the legacy system. So by end of this course duration, how confident I will be, like if I follow all your documents, all your steps and all your classes, how confident I will be to switch from my legacy to Velocity?
Yeah, if you have a very basic idea of what Salesforce is, I don't think it is going to take, after all these classes are done, if you regularly, once we discuss something about class, I mean, for example, if I discuss about data raptor extract, do a little practice of it so that you will understand, okay, I mean, all I can do is I can explain what exactly is a data raptor extract and how it works, what are all the things that may, encounter and all. But when you actually practice, you'll understand like, okay, what I have to enter in this particular area and handle if error comes and all, right? You do that, trust me, after this training, you will be able to directly, start working on it. And I'm saying with this with some confidence because I have experience of almost 1 year of training in Salesforce, in Velocity especially. And out of around 25 students until now, almost 16 have got placed immediately after the training, and they have sent me messages like thank you and everything, right? Because I have experience of around working in 6 to 7 different Velocity projects until now, right? I have done some support work as well. So what I am doing, what we do in our training is not just, I don't just simply explain, okay, this is that and that is that. We'll practically do each and every, work on each and every each and every component that is here, and we'll also I'll try to explain you comparing with the actual scenario that you may face. Telling about SQL query, saying that okay, SQL query is used to extract so and so data from so and so object is going to be simple, but telling you where exactly it will be useful, how to handle those situations is going to make you little more understand more. So that's what we are going to do. I'll show you practical examples, like just how this whole that's what we do in our training here. I'll try to explain the actual scenarios that happen in your these website. I mean, these are the two projects which I have worked in, two of those projects which I have worked in, and I can show you the live examples along with what we do. And as part of our training, we'll first thing is like the we'll do this training, right? And we'll work with a live example every day, and I'll try to provide you, we'll provide a login access to VelocityOrg. VelocityOrg is not open source. You cannot just get the access like Salesforce. It is a closed source. So we'll try to provide the login access as well. We'll try to give you, there is just like Salesforce, success community. Velocity also has a success community. Yeah, this is that success community where you'll find, you know, certain documentation, like if you have any questions, you can do that, or you can find some documentation, all that. We'll provide this access as well. And at the end of training, we'll provide you all the, I have myself out of my own interest, I have created certain how-to documents. I mean, even after the training, if you get stuck at using a particular component, like let's say a certain element in OmniScript, you can just simply refer those documents and you can use it. And we discuss, I mean, this is pretty much about Velocity. I mean, these are all together called as Velocity, not just, I mean, mostly people try to get the details of this order capture and they think that's what Velocity is, but no. If you actually look at Velocity, the order management, EPC, CPQ, these are the things that clients are getting more excited, and that's why they are actually working with Velocity. So we'll discuss in detail about each and everything which I have mentioned here. For example, right from creating a product and pricing it and doing the order capture journey and order management, we'll try to cover all these topics in these 40 hours of training.
Okay, thank you. So actually I joined in late. So the duration of this course is 3 months or 1 month?
It's 1 month. 1 month is, it's basically almost comes to 30 hours at least.
Okay.
So 30 classes are minimum. So yeah, I mean, that is more than enough to understand Velocity, because it's not a code or something. It's just about knowing what Velocity is providing, and it's all about your application, how you apply each of these things.
Understood. So yeah. There is no much of the programming language or Apex knowledge is required, right? It's all configs for now.
Yes, exactly. You don't, only place you would require code is, and until now I have been to working in so many projects, right? It's basically, they will have a UI UX team to work on this part, right? I mean, any normal Salesforce guy, any other people, they don't know this Angular JavaScript or something especially, right? So most of the projects have this UI UX teams who handle this Android, iOS, and this web application part. So you don't have to bother much about it. We'll cover all the other topics.
Okay, fine, thank you.
Yeah.
So Dilip, this coding is except templates. I saw a few codings in the integration process as well as like, as you said, the calculation procedures in, as an insurance company works a lot on calculation procedures. I think a few of the, Apex coding will be like built in there by using the elements, right?
For example, here in this place, you are not at all using any code in these integration procedures, which I have seen, or we are dealing with so much of logic here, right, related to add-ons, and not even one single place we have used code.
Oh, on the right
definitely.
Side. Yeah. On the right side. On the right side.
This one. This is not actually a code. It's just like, for example, as I said, this HTTP action is used to invoke an API. That's what Velocity has defined. all you have to do is drag and drop that HTTP action, and on the right side you define, okay, what is the endpoint, what is the method type, or what is the parameters. So on the right side you are going to define your properties so that you're configuring the velocity provided elements in such a way that you can use it in for your own purpose. On the right side, whatever you see, that is actually not a code, it's just how you want to configure each of these elements.
Dilip, thank you for the session. Actually, you said that there will be 30 hours training for that. Will there be any live project after that? And if you say something about any certification about this velocity or something, please.
I didn't get your question completely.
Yeah, can you hear me now? Is it audible?
Yeah, I can hear.
So you told that the course will be 30 hours course, right? 30 classes probably. Yeah. So after that, will there be any live project or something, that a project end to end from scratch? So we'll be getting that. And also, if there are any other certifications on velocity, Salesforce have a lot of certifications like that only.
Okay. Live project in the sense, we are not providing any project as such, but what we do is, for example, here, there are certain products here, right? So right from how to configure these products till how to handle end-to-end. You can configure this product, you can define the pricing, you have to create an order capture journey in order to, make sure that customers come in and choose that product and proceed on with their journey, till order management process. We'll just take example, and definitely we are going to see how each and everything goes on.
Okay.
Yeah. And as part of certifications, just like how Salesforce has, there are a lot of certifications, but if you are looking for any, job in Velocity, then I recommend Velocity Platform Developer. There is one certification. You have to take that.
Okay. Thank you.
Hey, Dilip, this is Vishal. So as you know, Salesforce offers other different offerings, just like Demandware and Cloudways, where, based upon the use case, B2C and B2B digital commerce and card-based solutions are there for the enterprises. So how do we differentiate Velocity in terms of, technical stack placement, how it is different from those offerings, and how a company would choose a particular option, or where do we differentiate the Velocity in that terms?
Okay. Velocity is entirely different. For example, in Salesforce you have Marketing Cloud or Health Cloud, all these things, but what Velocity is doing here is, for example, this telecom domain, choosing this product and going ahead with the payment and everything, that is all fine, but in the backend, there are so many objects that are involved. There are so much of complex logics that are involved. So Velocity is providing you all of that, including the data model, and it makes the development easy by providing these tools, data and interaction tools.
So it's a kind of managed package, I hope, right?
Yeah, it's a managed package, yes.
Okay.
Thanks. Yeah. For example, in a particular org, you are using Velocity. That means you will be able to see it in the managed package. If you go to your org, if it is a Velocity org, then they have domain-specific packages. For example, if it is a telecom domain, the package is Velocity CMT. If it is an insurance domain, package is Velocity INS, something like that. Even if you go to objects, you see.
But
these are all.
So Salesforce also has those B2C and B2B solutions. They also provide the same kind of capabilities. Then how do we differentiate in terms of using Velocity? So being a company, shall I use Velocity or shall I use, let's say, B2B cloud offering from Salesforce? Because both provide same kind of capabilities, card-based mm-hmm. solution, digital commerce, and, you know, I can have those template-based themes, and what should I use in that case?
Right. If you go for normal Salesforce to build an application, first of all, your order capture journey is going to become more complex because you have to use so many lightning components and so much of code has to be used. So that's one point where your order capture can be entirely declarative approach, except for those adding that rich UI. Everything else is going to be a declarative approach. So the advantage of going for declarative approach is, for example, I am a developer who is creating an Apex class. I follow a certain standard, and there is another developer, he follows a certain, his way of coding is different. So ultimately, when applications, like after 4 or 5 years of development, you see that there is a lot of code, and each and every code has a different way. I mean, although most of the projects have set, certain rules, like you have to use custom labels and avoid hard codings and all, but still, right, the way the individual developer codes is different. But if you use a declarative approach, you don't have any other way around. You just only have one way, drag and drop and configure it. You, even while configure, there are no other ways. You have to provide certain details where they are required. That's all. And second thing is, order management process is the most used feature of Velocity across the domains. And most of the projects are, some of the projects, as far as I know, just come, you start using Velocity only for the order management, because it's that dynamic. You can build such complex logics, yet it is so simple for the developers, right? The orchestration process, I mean, when we discuss clearly, we'll see what exactly it is. It's like, the way you create dependencies on each of the tasks. For example, if you buy a SIM card, only after the SIM card is activated, you have to activate your plan, right? So you generate certain flows in the backend, and you create dependencies all in the backend, all of that in the order management process, which is the most dynamic one. The next thing is EPC part. In EPC, it's not just about creating some products and creating certain things. There are much more, for example, this is one screen where you actually work with your products, right? You product is just simple. I mean, you create a record in your product catalog object, and that's it. But Velocity is giving you so much more to, how to configure a single product. For example, this particular bill plan is a product which is provided by this company, right? So all you can do in your product catalog object is just simply create a, basic information. But here you are going to define certain attributes, like what is the data, minutes, SMS, all that. And you can create a product structure. When I mean product structure, for example, if you go to Amazon, if you buy, this frequently bought together, right? Usually, these telecom companies, what they do, if you buy a mobile phone and a SIM card and a plan and add-on, they'll reduce the price and give you, and that total thing is called as a product bundle, right? You can buy each of those products individually, but if you buy them together, the pricing has to be different, right? That kind of structures you can define in Velocity pretty easily, like it's very easy in Velocity. You just come to this product structure, you define the child products to a particular product, and if you want to make sure that pricing is different when you buy a bundle and when you buy an individual product, you can do that as well here. And finally, this digital commerce and card based APC, is I mean already there in Salesforce, but Velocity is giving you few more, you know, scenarios. Did that answer your question? Were you?
Yep. Thanks for that.
Dilip, one question. I don't know whether it is like a silly question or not. I just ask you. In right. case of say in Salesforce, there is a web. It is a different kind of web page dashboard for the for the desktop, like laptops or whatever thing, and it is different web page for the mobile. It like a mobile one app. So mm-hmm. it is really different. If Velocity is it's only for mobile app or it's like.
If you build an OmniScript, you can use it for any purpose. I will show you. OmniScripts are not specific to mobile, or OmniScripts are not specific to web application. And you can see, for example, you build an application and you can make it, you can basically see how it is working in a mobile app. Basically, OmniScript can be used in anywhere. It is not specific to community, or it is not specific to a mobile app or anything. You can use these OmniScripts anywhere, and you can preview how it is going to look here itself. Great. This has been configured in a little different way, but yeah. You basically have that flexibility to build your OmniScript to make sure that it is, it will be, you know, it can be used in anywhere.
Okay. And another thing is that certain places we have to use LWC as right.
Mm-hmm.
So LWC will be like taken care in this session, in this training sessions.
No, LWC is like an entirely different thing. It's like, if you talk about that again, it's like going, away from Velocity.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll discuss entirely about Velocity here. And yeah, LWC is required, but yeah, it's just like how, it's just a replacement of AngularJS, which is already there. So yeah.
So that will be covered or no?
No, not in this.
Okay.
Yeah.
Hi, Dilip.
Yeah, hi.
Dilip, how do we enable this Velocity for any Salesforce org? So can it be a? Yeah.
It's a managed package. You have to download it and you have to buy the license.
Okay, so it's the same process which we follow for other packages, right?
Yes, exactly. Yes.
Okay.
And there are these little details of Velocity that gives, that makes, more sense. Like, for example, for every component that you get in Velocity, you have a preview, right? So every minor change you make, if you want to see how it looks, you can just go preview and you can change the type of view you want. Or, for example, I'm working on building an API. I can see how it is, I can pass the inputs over here in the JSON format or in the key value pairs. I can simply click on execute. I can see how it is going to work. For example, usually for APIs, we use Postman and see how it is all and all, right? You don't require all that. For every component Velocity provides, you have a preview. You can do the unit testing then and there itself. Any other questions or anything? Any other clarifications you need?
So Dilip, with a very limited knowledge of the LWC, is it okay, or we should have some deep knowledge on LWC?
I would say that LWC in Velocity is not yet that stabilized. They are still working on it. So it is going to take a while. I mean, at least this 1 year. Yeah, later on, you may need LWC knowledge in order to enrich your UI. Other than that, there is no purpose of LWC much here, because I'll show you something. If you speak about, other than that enriching UI, if you speak about how much of LWC is impacting your velocity, it's just that if how your classic version of Salesforce and Lightning version of Salesforce is, it's all in the appearance side. So that is the only difference you will be able to see in velocity as well. I'll show you one. For example, this is an OmniScript. This is a normal version of OmniScript. All you have to do is just check this checkbox, enable LWC. And the impact of LWC in velocity, in when you speak in velocity terms, is it's just the same difference how Classic and Lightning has the appearance, right? But if you want to enrich your UI, in that case, yeah, you have to write an LWC component and add it to the OmniScript. But otherwise, yeah, there is not much of a difference.
Okay. Thank you. That answers the question.
Yeah. If you are good with velocity and it's more than enough. I mean, if you are, velocity is not just about order capture. Most of the people and most of the trainings, they only talk about order capture. And I clearly say that order capture is just one part, and it's not even that, great. I mean, it's great, but it's not even like, the best feature of velocity. The best feature of velocity are like this order orchestration or EPC or CPQ, right? If you are good with all these things, you can call yourself as a velocity expert, and you don't have to bother about this LWC and other things much.
Sure, thank you.
Yeah.
And at the end of session, do we get a recorded session, or what in case if we miss any session during the journey?
Okay. I will give an answer. We'll start do the recording for each day. The end of the class, you will get the recording.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Each day, you will get the recording.
This is an LWC OmniScript. The only difference is the appearance. You can still do what you are doing. I don't even use LWC. Even in Salesforce, I prefer using Classic still, right? So it doesn't make much difference to me. Only when you want to add any extra UI, that case, it is like mandatory. Even now, you have to add an Angular template, but instead, you use a LWC template. That's all.
Okay. Yeah, even in Salesforce, even though it says LWC, but it takes a lot of time to load. It's not lightning speed.
Right, Classic. Exactly. Yeah, any other questions or anything?
So, hi, this is Akash. I wanted to understand, what are the other certifications? You mentioned about Velocity App Builder, but if you want to go for, let's say, advanced certification, are there any more, or is that the only one that is available specifically for Velocity?
Specifically for Velocity, there are more actually. But unlike Salesforce, having so many certifications but at the same level, these guys have a different level. If you want to be a normal developer, then you can go for Velocity Platform Developer. If you want to be an architect, then there is a different certification for that, which gives you that architect credential. Or if you are a consultant, then you have a different thing. So based on the level of you, based on the level you want, there are different types of certifications.
Okay, thank you.
In Salesforce, we just have for a developer itself, they have to go through a lot of certifications like PD1, PD2. Again, you have App Builder, again, you have Admin, all these things, but it's not like that here. It's based on the levels. If you're a developer, you have different set of certifications. If you're a consultant, then different. Then if you are an architect, then there are different like that. I'll share you that document with details of all the certifications.
Yeah, okay. We already, okay, out of the time. Okay, we will end up the today's session. Okay, I would like to inform you that the regular batch will start from Monday onwards, the same time, 7:30 a.m. IST. Okay, if you want to enroll yourself, you have to be contact the SV Tech Serv by today or tomorrow. The regular batch will be start from Monday onwards, same time. As we mentioned earlier, we will share you some all some access, okay, access for Velocity. We will share you the recording sessions also. We will help you in certifications also, okay, at this end of the course, certification especially. Do you guys have any doubts? If you all good, then we are end up with the session.
Yes, we are all good.
Okay, see, if you have any questions or anything, please contact to SV TechSup. You already have my email address and mobile number, right? You can contact. Okay, I'm repeating again, the regular batch will be start from day after tomorrow as per an IST, 7:30 a.m. IST. Okay, the weekend also we will take some special sessions related to the interview. Okay, some interview and some real time scenario, like some discussion only, not any class related.
So, the classes will be like from Monday to Saturday or Monday through Friday?
See, Monday to Saturday like that, because of Saturday have some extra time for everyone, right? Okay. We can discuss that would be at 7:30 or 8, especially in weekend. Okay. We can discuss that.
So, it will be 6 days a week, right?
Yes, Doctor. Yes. Okay. 5 days in a week, like the classes. Saturdays, and as I told you, there is some optional class that will be related to interview, okay? some interview question discussions, like that. Because of so many people, you know, so learning this course, especially to grow in their career, right? Okay, with Velocity. Mm-hmm. Make sure they have idea actually what question will be coming in real time, what are the scenarios. Those things we'll discuss, especially in the weekend.
Okay.
Because actually, you know, actually some discussion will take a lot of time, right? 1.5 or 2 hours, right? If we have discussion in the regular batch, actually, okay, the complete batch will get disturbed. That is the reason we are actually planning to conduct that session, especially in the weekend.
Okay.
Okay. What are questions so far in the last week? Okay. What are questions will be coming in real time?
Yeah, that for sure I can help you out. I already have documented a lot of interview questions. We can discuss each and every one of them. We'll try to cover interview questions as well.
Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you, everyone. Okay. I am ending up today's session. I will share you the recording also. Okay. If you haven't shared your email address, okay, please share to my WhatsApp number. Dilip, actually, can you show the emails as we take up?
Sure. Yeah.
Okay. See, okay. This is my email address and contact number. Please contact. Okay. Just you can register. We can start the regular batch from Monday onwards. Okay. For any doubts and clarification, please contact as we take up.
So I sent the email. So do it still need to send you in the WhatsApp my email ID?
Yes, yes. Okay. Please send in WhatsApp your email address. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Thank you, everyone. Thanks for the time. Thank you. Bye.